Moroke Phajane. Welcome to everyone who's logged in to our first webinar on positioning your new firm as a successful business. I would just like to maybe, I think it's only proper that I introduce myself. You may have looked at the adverts and seen who I am. I'm an admitted attorney. I was previously in private practice, where I worked as an associate at Bell Dewar in Hall, which is now called Fasken Martineau in Centre Johannesburg. I then left Bell Dewar to practice for my own account, and I joined a law firm called Thompson Wilkes as a partner practicing for my own account. That's where the entrepreneurial bug, that's where it led me, where I then experienced firsthand what it's like to generate your own fees, to pay your own overheads, your own salary, to have your own client base, and the marketing and everything, the strategy that has to be formulated to make sure that you have as much clients as possible. So yeah, I then left Thompson Wilkes and joined Liberty in Braamfontein, Johannesburg, as an in-house attorney. At Liberty, I work in the group legal department, where I provide strategic legal support to the various business units in the organization. And I'm also at the moment a board member for an organization called the Corporate Lawyers of Association. The name has been changed to Corporate Council of South Africa. I'm serving on their training subcommittees there as well. So in a nutshell, that's who I am, that's what I'm about. Today I'll be talking to you about positioning your new firm as a successful business, and I'll be sharing some of my experiences which I gained while I was still practicing for my own account, and some of the experiences gained through being an in-house attorney at Liberty. Just before we proceed, just some ground rules, if I may, for lack of a better word. You'll see on your right hand side that there's a chat page or chat section where you are able to pose your questions as we move along. There will be a question and answer session towards the end of our webinar. So just as we go along, I can see a few participants are already greeting me there. I acknowledge you. So just as we move along, you just pose your questions there, and just ensure that your speakers are on silent. I think that is an icon. If you have any technical problems, our technical team is in the background. They'll be able to see that and address it as we move along. So just to proceed, I think before we can talk about positioning your new firm as a successful business, we first have to agree on one point. As a point of departure, is whether a law firm is a business, because we cannot talk about positioning it as a successful business if we have not agreed on whether it's a business. Law firms are usually treated, whether that's correctly or incorrectly, as if they are exempt from the normal business rules. So how about we look at what the definition of a business is? You'll see that I've got the definition. One definition says it's an organization involved in the trade of goods or services to consumers. Another definition says it's the activity of making, buying, or selling goods, or providing services in exchange for money. So law firms provide services in exchange for money. So the law firms do fall under that definition. So as attorneys, we are not exempt from what a normal business has to do, from you know, ensuring that they market their services, that they have proper strategies in place. So a law firm qualifies as a business. So if now we're saying a law firm falls under that category of a business, If we look at the stats, which is probably why are we doing this? Why are we having webinars, seminars? Are we having all these talks about law firms and trying to position them as successful businesses? If you look at the stats, I've got those are unofficial stats. They don't come directly from the Law Society, but that's what an article that I came across that was in the Mail and Guardian thought leader. On 13 April 2013, you can look, it just gives you a picture, although unofficial, but it gives you a picture of the crisis that we're having at the moment. If you look at the national figures there, or the national stats, about 78 attorneys have been struck from the roll. In KZN alone, there were about 11 inquiries, 29 attorneys suspended, 4 struck from the roll. These are not updated, it was the way in 2013. The Cape Law Society, you've got about 3,269 complaints, 229 upheld. In the Free State, there were about 27 complaints at that time. Northern provinces, you have about 203 inquiries, and about 23 of those were upheld. Without looking deeper into the scientific methodology that was used to calculate and so on and so on, I think it just gives us a picture to say there are complaints out there. There are disciplinary proceedings out there. A lot of attorneys have been struck from the roll, and there may be many reasons for that. But I think one of the reasons is the fact that attorneys or most law firms are not in a position that they are properly positioned as businesses, as we've looked at the definition of businesses. So why do startup law firms fail? As I just indicated, it's mostly because most of them are not properly positioned as a business. And there is that approach that we followed over the years as attorneys that we're not necessarily like any other business. Yes, we are a specialized function, but we do, as we've looked at that definition, fall under the category of a business. So like any other business, if a law firm is not properly positioned, it will not be able to take advantage of any opportunities that present themselves or mitigate against threats, you know, that are posed to the business. So it's very important that the business should be properly positioned. So when we're talking about positioning, what does it mean in this context? You know, positioning can have a lot of meanings. It has a lot of meanings in the marketing context, but what are we talking about? A gentleman called Andrew Finlayson, who's a co-founder of a company called Maven Wealth, was asked, what is the secret of being a good entrepreneur? And I've quoted that verbatim. I liked what his response was. He said, it's to have the ability to see what the future may hold and translate that vision into a business strategy that you can implement now. So when you are properly positioned, in my view, is that you now have that ability to see what the future may hold, and you are able to translate whatever it is that you are seeing into a business strategy that you can implement now. So every action becomes deliberate, it's structured. You when you're doing something, you're not reactive, it's more proactive. You are sort of able to predict what is coming up, what will be happening in your environment, and you are able to take advantage of any opportunities that are out there, and you are able to mitigate against the threats that come through. But I think what's most important then is how. Is it by just looking into a crystal ball and seeing the future? And no, I think the best way to do that is basically by making sure that you have a proper marketing strategy in place, a strategy that is formulated that will enable you to plan, to enable you to foresee things that are coming, and as I said, to be able to take advantage of the opportunities and to mitigate against the threats. So maybe to go deeper into this. Issue about positioning, we should maybe look at, take a scenario for example. XYZ being a firm of attorneys, the newly formed firm of attorneys. So you've just started up, left somebody's employment, now you're practicing for your own account. What are the essential factors that as XYZ should consider from a marketing and strategy perspective? to guarantee the success of such a business. So we've said that the only way you'll be positioned is if you treat the firm as a business. And we've said the only way that you'll be able to be positioned is if you are able to foresee, to have that vision and to be able to implement or formulate a strategy that can be implemented now. With that strategy, you are able to take advantage of the opportunities and be able to mitigate against the threats. So what factors should be considered from a marketing and strategy perspective to guarantee XYZ success? I think the best way, the approach would be to do the following. One would be to analyze XYZ's current position, to conduct a situation and analysis. That will enable you to then secondly determine where the firm wants to be, where XYZ wants to be. And thirdly, to XYZ will be able to ascertain how the company can get to where it wants to be. So one, you conduct the situational analysis in order to determine where the firm wants to be. And then that will enable you to ascertain how to get to where it wants to be. So we'll be looking at that in more detail. The first part, which is the situational analysis, it's more about knowing your current situation. That you're looking there at your macro environment, which is the external environment, and then you are looking at your micro environment, which is your internal environment. The tools that can be used in that instance, we have, I've listed there, you can see there's PEST, there's competitor analysis, there's Porter's five forces, that's what is commonly known as SWOT analysis. So we'll look into detail into what those tools entail. Those are the tools that you can use to conduct that situational analysis. So the PEST analysis, PEST stands for political, economic, social, and technological. So basically you're looking at your political, stroke legal factors, your economic factors, the social factors, and the technological factors. So the political factors have included it as legal. Sometimes you hear it will be called PEST-L just to include the legal part. But I think political is also maybe more within the legal framework. And you look because there we look at the regulatory framework of rules, policies, and legislation. In the context of attorneys, it will be probably the Attorneys Act, Legal Practice Act. There may be legislation that deals with taxation, like the Income Tax Act, the Value Added Tax Act. So that's what we look at. We look at those factors and say, what are the factors that we analyze those factors? What are the factors that needs to be looked at from a political or legal perspective? Then we have the economic factors. When you look at the economic factors, there you look at the state of the economy, and which will be now the direct impact of the state of the economy on customers' behavior. If you look at what is happening in the country or in the environment that you're operating in from an economic perspective, then it will tell you how that dictates demand. It will tell you how customers or clients are willing to spend. So the spend patterns, the demand, so you are able to understand. So if there's a high inflation rate, will clients now be able to afford legal fees? Will they be willing to be spending money on legal fees? So you look at all those factors and you look at what is happening in the economy. The third factor will be the social factor, or the social factors. There we look at the demographics of the customer. The demographic or cultural component of the customer, that includes levels of education. You look at the geographic location, the age, the mixes, the gender. So you analyze your environment and you say, in this environment that I want to operate in, if it's South Africa, if it's Johannesburg, or if it's Cape Town, Bloemfontein, whichever city you're operating in, you look at that in this environment, what does the population look like? What are the levels of the education of the people residing there? The age, the mixes, the gender mixes, and all of that. One of the tools that you can use, I mean, platforms that you can use to search for this information is the Statistics South Africa website. It gives you all that information for free. You may have noticed every year or every once in a while we have the census team going house to house trying to count who stays there, who, you know, that gives that, that's where that information, how that information is collated. So Statistics South Africa, Stats SA, can give you that information where you can know that per area, who are, what type of people are staying there, how many people, what is the you know, the population, the size of the population, the levels of education, and so on and so on. The fourth factor is the technological factor. This deals with the advances and innovation, which can have an impact on the services and processes. So what we look at there is technology plays a role in the business or in the environment that we operate in. So you look at what has an impact on that environment. For example, communication. We're living in the modern era where now clients prefer certain ways of communicating. So when you look at communication, you've got SMSs, you've got emails. Recently, we now have social media. So you analyze that and say, in the environment that I'm operating in, our clients, what is the preference of my customers? How do they want to communicate with me from a technological point of view? You look at your processes and see how, what impact does technology have on these processes? Do clients want to have face-to-face meetings, or will they rather prefer to do a Skype? How will I be invoicing my client? How do clients prefer to pay? Is it by EFT? Will they like to pay cash? Do you have card facilities, and so on? And so on. So you look at technological factors, even from your research point of view, what type of technology can you invest in? So those are some of the things that you look at. So the next tool that we look at is the competitor analysis. Remember, we're still conducting a situational analysis. We're still looking at the situation that we are in, where we are now. So we're analyzing our situation. We're conducting a situational analysis. So we looked at past. The second tool then is a competitor analysis. So a competitor analysis is literally analyzing your competitors. So you start by identifying key competitors and looking at their profiles. So you look at what are their objectives. You look at their strategies, and you look at their strengths and weaknesses. So that will enable you to then at least see what gaps are there in the market for services. You are able to say, okay, if my competitors are providing XYZ, I can now provide ABC. You look at the fees that your competitors charge so that you are able to now compete from a fee point of view, to say they are charging XYZ and these are probably their overheads, so you can come up with competitive fees to be able to penetrate the market. You also look at the process and technology that is used by your competitors. Like we've mentioned when we're looking at pest, the pest analysis, the technology aspect and the process. So for you to get more information as you're conducting that analysis is to look at your competitors. You can actually identify there some of the things that you can also use, or maybe use something better compared to what they are using. So you look at the processes that they follow. When we say processes, we're looking at when you're engaging a customer, how are clients able to engage with you? How are clients able to procure your services? If they are looking for an attorney, is it a question of them calling your reception? From there, consultation is arranged. So you look at how your competitors are operating. You look at the technology, and then you look at the people. The people is, you look at their team, you look at the staff that is involved in the provision of the services, from attorneys to admin support staff. You look at the profile and expertise of the people involved in the provision of the services who work for your competitor. And that can also give you ideas as to what is it that you need to augment as far as your expertise is concerned. Do you need more people? Do your people need to go on courses? Do you need to go on certain courses? So you look at all of those using the information that you get from your competitors. Where can you find this information? Is very easy. Nowadays, technology helps us. You find all these things usually on the internet, on websites, and so on and so on. So we've looked at pest. We're still conducting our situation analysis. We looked at the pest analysis. We've done the competitor analysis, and then we look at another tool called Porter's Five Forces. So Porter's Five Forces, you've got competitive rivalry, you've got supplier power, barriers to entry, buyer power, and threat of substitutes. So competitive rivalry it's influenced by all those factors because that's where you see how concentrated the market is. How many players do you have in the market? Is there a rivalry in that market? So as you are preparing, you've made a decision. Preferably, these things are done way before you even start. You even set up, but you're already there. You've made a decision that look, I'm starting up, but then you want to know how many players are there. How competitive is this environment? So we look at that, and you also look at the whole environment. You say, okay, supply power. In this context, because law firms, we are in the provision of services. We don't provide goods or products. We provide service. Supplier power that I identified as a supplier in this instance could be where we are not getting clients, I mean, directly, where you go through maybe another institution, which is like maybe like nowadays we have legal insurance institutions like your Scorpion Legal Protection, your LegalWise, your Clienteles, where they have their clients, they provide an insurance policy to the client, then the attorneys are on their panels. So in my view, those could qualify as suppliers because they supply you with the business. They supply you with the business. So you analyze that and you say, what power do these type of suppliers have in this context? So in the, with the your insurance companies that I've mentioned, what I know normally what normally happens is you have tariffs, for example. You can't come as an attorney and say, look, I'll be t charging an attorney a client fee, or I'm charging on an hourly rate at 1,500 per hour. They dictate to you what the tariffs will be. I know it's basically most of the time it's on a party and party scale. So there, right there, and then you are now aware, you list that and you get, this is the power that they have as suppliers. They are able to dictate their prices. So when you say supply power, you can rate it. You can either say, is it high or is it low or is it medium to give you that picture of what how much power suppliers have in that environment. And the barriers to entry, that basically speaks to how easy it is for other people to enter into the market. Do you as far as economics of scale are concerned, is it just an easy type of environment to enter? Because that will inform you as to whether you're entering into an environment where, I mean, as they usually say, every Tom, Dick, and Harry will be able to go in. And once you have many players, then it may be quite difficult for you to operate. So, by barriers of entry, you look at how difficult is it for you to enter into for players to enter into that market. So you look at maybe cost of capital. Is it quite to get to obtain to enter into that market? From a technology, how much do you need to invest? You need a lot of people working for you. So those are the kind of things that you look at. So what you will do in this instant as well is to say, is it high? Is it low? Is it medium? So the barriers to entry, you are aware of them now as you are conducting your situational analysis. The third force will be the buyer power. But the buyer refers to your clients. It refers to your customers. So in this instance, what power do customers or clients have over you as a service provider? So do the clients or customers have the power to dictate prices, for example? Do customers have a power to dictate how services should be provided? So you have looked at, when you started, you looked at the competitive rivalry. You've looked at how many players there are in the market. So now, if the power of clients will be maybe if you are saying I provide this service at 800 per hour, the client is able to just go to another player in the market who will provide it at 700. So in such a way, because there are so many people providing the same service, clients now have the power because they can pick and choose. You'll remember when we looked at the technological factors under pest, we also saw how clients are able to dictate the way they would like to communicate with attorneys or with the service provider. But you also know that with the internet and all of that, clients now in the modern era are able to conduct their own research. They're able to access and to get more information on other alternative service providers. So that is an example of what buyer power is in this context. So what you'll be doing there is to say, is it high? Is it low? Again, you listed, it gives you a picture of what's out there, of the environment. Then the last force under Porter, so it's called Porter's Five Forces because it was something that a gentleman called Michael Porter, who's a professor, I think at Harvard University, came up with, who's very prominent in the marketing and strategy field. So the last one will be threat of substitutes. So a threat of substitutes, it's more that a simple example would be, will the customers or clients be able to do this themselves and not consider you as an attorney? We've had recently, templates are being sold over the counter. So people are able to buy lease agreements, wills over the counter and just populate them. So that's an example of the threat of substitute. Another example could be your corporate entities like the one I work for, where they are now on a drive to recruit admitted attorneys to come and work for them in-house. So instead of instructing or briefing attorneys, external attorneys, they now have their own people in-house. They are doing it for themselves. So that's another example of a threat of substitutes. So again, what you do there is you point out whether is it high. If the threat of substitute is high, it gives you a picture now of what to expect out there. Is it low? Is it medium? So another tool that is used, we've looked at we've done a pestle analysis. We're still busy with the situation analysis. We've done the pest analysis. We've looked at the competitor analysis. We've looked at the Porter's Five Forces. So now we're doing a SWOT analysis. SWOT is the most common of them all. Basically, it stands for strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. So what you do there is you look at your strengths as XYZ, because we're still focusing on that scenario. As a firm, you look at your strengths, that what are my strengths? And where there are strengths, it means you'll be able to identify opportunities that with these strengths, this is where I will be able to excel. This is the service that I'll be able to provide that I'm not seeing out there. And when you look at weaknesses, you are able to see, okay, this is where I need to, I'm not as strong as probably my competitors, because remember, you've already even done your competitor analysis. So this is where maybe I need to gain more courses. Maybe I need more support. I need to get, more people who are specialized in this area, whatever it is. But then with weaknesses, you have threats. So then you are able to, when you're doing your SWOT analysis, you're able to say, these are the weaknesses and these are the threats. And then you come up with a way of how we will mitigate. Is it maybe gaining further education? Is it getting more resources? Is it forming alliances or corporations with other people? And so on and so on. So that's more your SWOT analysis as a tool that we use to conduct a situational analysis. So the second part will be, where would XYZ like to be? Remember, when we started with the situational analysis, we're looking at where XYZ is currently. So the second step now is, where would XYZ like to be? So for XYZ to determine where it would like to be, it has to set objectives. And I believe you can't just go into the market and say, I'm starting out a business and these are my objectives. For you to be able to set objectives and know that this is what I want to do, you need to be able to see what the demand is, the demand for such service. So you analyze and you do a demand for what is called a demand forecasting and say, at what time do people require the services that I'm looking at? That will enable you to set your objectives. For example, if you're looking at you are going to estates, if you're specializing in estates, you are able to see whether at what time do people require, you know, the, these kind of services. If you're looking at going into maybe criminal law, for example, you're able to see this, it is at this time that people require this type of services. What time in the year do people require this type of services? You know, so that's demand forecasting. Another aspect that you can look at this when you, as you're setting your objectives, is to look at the market needs. As I already said, you look at the size and growth of the market. So there's no point in saying these are my objectives. You find that the market doesn't necessarily need that, or the size of the market is so small that, you know, it's not going to grow in the next 5 years. So it's not worth you investing a lot of money into that. So those are the things that you looked at. And from there, now you are ready to set your objectives. So to set your objectives, you need to now then determine your marketing strategy. Your marketing strategy, I'll start with what doing a segmentation, targeting, and position, what is called an STP process. I'll take you through that. So segmentation is basically categorizing. It's literally to segment, to categorize your potential customers or clients into classes or into categories. In South Africa, we have what is called the living standard measurements, in terms of which clients or consumers are classified or categorized. So you have from LSM 1 up until 10. So consumers are categorized in terms of their living standards or the standard of living. So you can have the lowest will be 1. And the highest will be 10. So what they look at, you know, using that tool, is they look at where the, you know, the urbanization of consumers, where consumers stay, the type of you can say not gadgets, but you know, goods and movable goods that they have, from electronic equipment and all those things. So and the work, the profession the person is in. So they take all those factors in and able to determine and classify across all races, to classify and say this person is in LSM 1. So then what they look at is, having looked at those goods, equipments that those people are more likely to buy, they're able to determine that people in this LSM are more likely to probably eat a certain type of restaurant, they're more likely to eat at the to purchase a certain type of vehicle. So that's how companies out there are able to strategize and say, these are the clients that we are targeting. If I'm selling BMWs, I know that I'm gonna go probably for example, just as an example, LSM 7, and say, from what I've looked at, this is what the people in LSM 7 are more interested in. If I'm going to maybe establish a gymnasium, I know that people in LSM 8 are more likely to you know, enroll as members of the gymnasium. So that's the segmentation process. So the targeting part is more, now you've segmented your customers or your clients, you know where they are. Just as part of segmentation, if you know that the kind of services that you'll be providing as an attorney, you know that I'm looking at, let's say, specialized services. You're looking at maybe commercial type of services like contracts and all that. So it means the people that you will be providing services to are more people who will be in the commercial area, who are owning businesses, who are running businesses. So you what you do is then you know that in that segment, these are the type of people I'll be providing the services to. And then when you look at targeting, it's where do you find these consumers? So you need to target them on your advertise, on you exposing your services. You're saying, these are the services that I provide. You need to know where to find them. I like to use an example of what one of the media groups are doing. For example, you find you have a media group like Media 24 or a newspaper like The Star. You'll find they don't just post their headlines anywhere on any road. Just, you know, it's done deliberately. They know that if they place the headlines on those, you know, the street poles, they know that on that specific route, that's where most of their customers travel. So it means they know where their customers stay. They are able to They know where their customers stay. They know which routes their customers take. So that's more targeting. For example, if you know that your customers or your client base, it's more people who are traveling in and out of the country or in and out of town. If they use, you know, they're flying in and out of the country, in and out of town, then the airport may be a best place for you to market your services, or you can put your adverts and so on and so on. You find with certain newspapers, they know that most of their clients are people who commute use taxis to commute. So they know on taxi routes, this is where we'll be placing our advertisement to position ourselves. So positioning, you remember when we started, I said positioning in the marketing context, we use it widely, but in the marketing context also, it has a specific description. So positioning in this context will be now how you position yourself in the minds of your customers. I'll use your the most well-known brands, for example, like if you look at cars, Volvo, you know, has positioned themselves as a safe car. So safety is important to them. Mercedes-Benz looks at comfort. So comfort is the best for them. Audi look at comfort, they look at safety. BMW looks at that it's more sporty. So Audi says they're a combination of all that. In the legal context, there's law firms. So what you need to look at, if you're positioning your mind in your brand in the minds of your customers, is what is it that you want your customer to remember about you? How do you want to be known to your customers? I will say professionalism. I will say empathy. I will say that you show them that you have time for them. So that's how you position your brand. And so those are the kind of things that you need to think about, that this is how I want to remember. For me, when I was still practicing, turnaround time was important for me. I wanted my clients to have that trust in me, that if they've given me something, they know that I won't take forever to come back to them. I was my one of the most senior people that I worked under, drill that in my head, that you know, a client should never give you a call to ask you how far are you with a matter. The client is paying, so every time when we'll get a call, you know, a client is asking how far are we, you'll get into trouble. So it's those kind of things. Those are just examples of how you can position yourself in the minds of your customers, that they know that when there's this type of an issue, this is the person you can trust. Then once you've done all of that, now you are able to work more in detail on your business vision, your mission, and your strategic intent. Because like I said earlier, this you have to be very deliberate about what you are doing and not just, you know, have things happening to you by mistake. So the third aspect, we looked at where XYZ currently is. We look at where XYZ would like to be. And now we need to look at now, how do you get to that point? How will XYZ get to that? XYZ can do that by looking at, by developing marketing mix tactics. Marketing mix tactics, there's a tool, they call it the 7 P's. So 7 P's, as you can see there, it's price, product, promotion, process, people, physical evidence, and place. So price in this context refers to the fees that you will be charging. So you've looked at the type of services that you'll be providing. You know the type of clientele that you want to be providing the services to. You've looked at your competitors. You know how much they are charging. So now if you know that, as I made an example earlier, that if you're going to look at states, or if you're going to be doing convincing work, you know that these are the type of fees structures that are already there. It's 3.5% of you know, executive fees. You know, with convincing fees, that there are tariffs in place. So you are able to determine, and that's what you do. You highlight it there, that this is how much I'll be charging. The product is not the services. Like I said, you now know what services you want to provide. Who do you want to provide it for? So you've looked at that, you've looked at what your competitors are providing, you've seen gaps. So you say, these are the services that I want to provide. So you listed there, this is what I would like to provide. Promotion, I just spoke about how you target when you're doing the SP process, how you target your potential customers. You know where they now stay. You've used the LSM tool to look at where they now stay. So you where do you promote yourself? Are they maybe work online most of the time? Do you, you know, how do you, you know, advertise your services? And then you look at processes. Remember when we were looking at competitor analysis, when we're looking at technology, you look at processes. How will process, the process has to be as seamless as possible for your customers. How does that work? Do you, from the time the client calls your office to the time the client is able to sit with you, for the time you provide a client with that advice, or if that contract that they want drafted, or that litigation matter that they need assistance with, how will that work? So that's where you look at your process. You've looked at how your competitors do it. You look at what are the standards out there. And now you determine, you say, okay, this is how I would like mine to work. So you can see that with the 7 P's, everything that we spoke about very briefly now is now, you're now starting to apply it. You now have all that information. So normally you find that people start here without knowing that they're here, without having done all that research. So the people, but remember when we're also looking at credit analysis, when you did your SWOT analysis, you now know who needs to, what type of people do I need to provide these services? If it's specialized services, do I have the specialist? Do I need to go on courses or take people on courses? Those kind of things. And then physical evidence, that's basically, for lack of a better word, I will say the look and feel of your brand. The look and feel can be anything from your website, the way it feels. You're looking at your logos, your business cards, your offices. If somebody, a client comes to your office, does that office instill trust? Does it show that you are a professional attorney, that you will provide them with quality service? So that's what you now look at. You now know the type of clients that you are looking at. If you are looking at a more conservative, you know, client base, you know, does this vibey brand that you want to show out there, does it speak to the type of client base? So that's why you make those kind of decisions. So a marketing strategy, remember you said you determine your marketing strategy, you take all those 7 P's into account, and then you say, this is what my strategy is will look like. This is how I intend to go out there and market myself. So you've formulated the strategy, and now you will be very deliberate in your actions. So from having your marketing strategy, you've looked at the 7 P's. The second plan is, the second part is to manage the resources that you have. And that you do it by coming up after having done all of this, that you've done your 7 P's, you've looked at the price, the product you want to provide, you've looked at the promotional aspect, but all those things that you've listed there, it means you need to have an action plan. You need to manage the resources. Action plan, it's not that complicated. It's who's going to do this, who's going to provide whatever it is that you've identified. You have there what is it that is going to be, you know, that you've identified as that needs to be done or actioned, and when does it need to be done. So you know that if you've set yourself timelines and they are not reached by this day, there has to be an explanation. You run it like a project. You say if it's on Amber, it means we are not moving, it's work in progress. If it's green, we know that everything has been done. If it's red, it means something is wrong, we're unable to move. So you track it, you look at timelines, and you say, this is where we are, and this is how far we've been. And the how part as to how will you be doing that? Did you do it through other people? Do you need, or, you know, what will you need in terms of, you know, implementing your plan or your strategy? So a strategy has to be a living document. It has to be something that you are working on a daily basis. And an action plan allows you to do that, to keep on reviewing it and looking at how far you are as far as that is concerned. So now that you've looked at that, you've conducted situational analysis, you've looked at where the firm wants to be, and you've looked at how the firm can get to that point, you are ready now to go out there and submit proposals to corporate clients or to any other client. But in this context, I just wanted to give helpful tips on what to consider as you submit proposals to corporate clients. So I think, you know, you to submit a proposal, you need to submit it to somebody who already knows about your firm. You know, being in an in-house attorney, we get on a day-to-day basis, I think more than 20 attorneys sending proposals to an email address, maybe one of the general email portals that we have, just sending a proposal and saying, look, I would like to be on your panel of attorneys. And it's very sad, and it's one of the reasons I'm doing this. It's very sad knowing that that attorney will not be considered because nobody knows about you. Nobody knows that you are good in that area that you say you are good at. They're just seeing a profile that is on paper that is just sent to them. So I usually say to most attorneys that you need to court them first. You need to make sure that when I say them, I mean the people that matter. If you talk about corporate clients, you need to know who is it that I need to target in those companies. As a legal firm, or do I think the legal people that exist in corporate entities, you've got risk people. They're called risk managers. You've got compliance managers. You've got legal people in the organization. You have people called contract managers as well, who deal mostly with procurement. So those are the kind of people that you target, and you say, where do I find these people? I've mentioned earlier that I sit as a board member of an organization called CLASA, or it's not called CASA, Corporate Council of South Africa. They've got many events around the country where you can go, networking events, or you can go and network with a lot of attorneys and risk people, you know, that are now in these corporate entities. And through those people, you'll be able to know what's important to these organizations, what are their needs. What's, for example, Protection of Personal Information Act is the buzzing thing right now because a regulator is being appointed. You'll know about that. I think about last year, the Labor Relations Amendment Act was quite important to me. A lot of companies that outsource services. So, you know, and I was surprised that there was no attorney that offered to come in-house to come in and say, look, this is what the changes are going to be about. This is what's in the pipeline. And, you know, so those kind of activities, or you know, actions, that's how you caught the resources within corporate entities. From there, you will be known. If you are always there, you always know what they're about. I've mentioned there that you can prepare and conduct presentations on legal topics, write articles, provide them with newsletters or brief opinions as to this is what's coming. You know, this is a dashboard of all the legislation that is coming that is relevant to you. Once you have done that, then you can move to a stage where they now know about you. And if now there are legal services that are required, you are now a well-known brand. Another point that I like to mention is that it's not easy for legal managers in-house to appoint a new startup law firm or somebody who's not necessarily that well known. So it's very important that you work on making sure that you are well known before you even ask for the work. So and you also need to share your success story strategically. Make sure that they know that this is what you've done. How you can do that, it's through your presentations. Maybe come there with, you know, a set of facts or a scenario of a case that you've worked on, and you show them how you dealt with that. Another opportunity that most attorneys miss is when they have matters against corporate entities. Mostly you'll be acting maybe for an individual against a corporate entity. I think that's one of the best platforms to market yourself. Some of the of the attorneys that we've procured services from, or we brought onto our panel, are attorneys that had matters against our organization, and we, having seen how they dealt with the subject matter, the professionalism, the knowledge base, you know, that's the best platform to advertise your services. So another way, when you're submitting proposals to corporate clients, usually corporate entities go on what is called an RFP, where they request service providers to submit proposals to them for the provision of those specific services. You find it happens across the board with all service providers, but that includes attorneys as well. Some companies send out an RFP and say, look, we've got, for example, say, there's a need for labor legal services. So we need a labor specialist to come and assist us with our labor matters in the organization. So what is it that they look out for when we send out? I sit on a lot of what they call them cross-functional sourcing teams. So you find in those teams, you've got people from finance who will be looking at the commercials. If it's IT, then you have the technical people from an IT point of view. If it's legal, you have a legal person sitting there. You have risk people sitting there. You have procurement people sitting there. So you have across the from the organization, you have that spectrum of people sitting there representing who will make a decision and choose the appropriate vendor for the services that are required. So what are the important factors that are considered? It's technical capability. So you've done everything that you've done so far when we're conducting situational analysis, when we looked at how where we want to be, setting objectives, determining your marketing strategy. So technical capability, now you know what professional resources you have. That's what they look at. The infrastructure, we've looked at technology, we've looked at processes. So everything now becomes applicable here. So what happens is there's a scoring method that is used. So maybe technical capability will be 60% of the scoring. Then they look at financial capability. Financial capability means if they appoint you as a service provider, would you be able to, is this a sustainable business? You don't want as a corporate entity to appoint someone as a service provider and tomorrow you hear that they're insolvent or they're bankrupt or they've been removed from the role, whatever happens. So they look at your financial capability to say, are you liquid, are you solvent? So the liquidity ratios and solvency ratios that the finance people will look at. So what I would advise is for attorneys to make sure that their bookkeepers, you know, they've got proper financial statement, which is a requirement anyway in terms of the Attorneys Act. So it's to make sure that you have proper financial statements in place and you are liquid and solvent, because that's a major factor. Financial capability, I mentioned there that it's important for business continuity, and that's why, and from a reputational point of view. So business continuity is mostly, do you have a business continuity plan? You'll find that at startups, we have key man dependencies. We have one person who's providing the services. That's why when you're looking at people and all those things, that's what you need to look at. Is that a weakness that you have one person? Corporate entities look at that, very carefully, because once you have one person providing the services, what happens if that person is sick or something happens to that person? Will there be business continuity? Will you be able to? So you need to show them that this is the plan I have, a business continuity plan, to say there may be a key man dependency, but I've got other resources that will be able to step in should this happen. The status is also very important. Corporate entities, remember, they are sourcing work from government, so they are on a drive to make sure that they're at appropriate BE levels. So make sure that you obtain advice on that, that your BE status is at a point that, you know, that specific organization that you're looking at, what they require, what is suitable as far as they are concerned. So they look at that. I think sometimes maybe 30% of the scoring when it's considered. So the other stuff, it will be more, you need to be in good standing with SARS. Obviously, you and your staff should not have any criminal record. And compliance with the Protection of Personal Information Act is also important, because you'll be handling probably customer information or personal information of clients, of their clients. So there's a requirement that, you know, corporate entities have to comply with POPI. So you need to demonstrate that you have measures in place to comply with that act. So there are many things that we can consider. But, you know, for the sake of time, we'll probably maybe have other parts of the series. I welcome any questions that can come even after this session. That's why I've put up there my email address. I've got a webpage there that can tell you all about me, who I am, what I do. And like I said, even after the session, I welcome any email queries. But I think we've got some time left, and I'll just at this stage open up the floor for any questions. Remember the chat section on your right hand side. I think it's on your left, it's on my right hand side. And it's on your right hand side, where you can just maybe send through some questions if you have any. So I'm assuming that we don't have any questions. Thank you. I'm seeing that I'm getting compliments. But like I said, if after the session, if there are any other questions, I'll be happy to respond to any of that. Thank you to Beverly. Thank you, Cassandra. Okay, Susan has got a question and said, can you elaborate on the plan and the marketing strategy of the portion of the slide? Marketing strategy portion of the slide. Under the 7 P's. Thank you, Susan. So under the 7 P's is after you've conducted everything or with all the information that you looked at, you have the, I said, the price, which will be the fee that you'll be charging. So you look at the fees that you'll be charging and you say, okay, I've looked at what my competitors are charging out there. These are the type of services that I would like to charge. These are the service that I would like to charge, and this is how much I will be charging. So if it's a state, you know that this is what I'll be looking at. If it's conveyancing, you know that this is how I will be looking at the place. If you look at place, I think that's what Susan wanted to deal with. Place is more like location. It's more, where will your offices be? I always say it's better to follow the money. If you know that your LSM 5, let's say, just as an example, you say a Woolies store provides the same, the same services, they provide products to the same LSM that you're targeting. And you know that in that office park or in that complex where Woolies is, that's where somewhere there, if Woolies is the anchor tenant, I have to make sure that my offices are somewhere there because that's where you'll be visible to your clients. Or again, with location, it's all about convenience to your client, that you, convenience to your clients, how convenient will it be for your target market or the LSM that you are targeting. I'm going to take another question. I hope I've answered your question, Susan. Thank you. Just Ronelda. Ronelda asked a question, what would you suggest or where do you suggest I start freeing up time to do the research and to conduct the situational analysis, et cetera, if I'm already in practice? Can I get help of this nature outside my firm? Definitely, Ronelda, there are people who specialize in this that I can refer you to. You who specialize in this, I can know. I also help a couple of businesses with conducting a situational analysis to understand, to come up with their own strategy, or we can refer you to people who are specialists in marketing. I'm just trying to look at the questions that are coming in. If I'm unable to deal with some of the questions now, I'll definitely deal with them, offline, and send you an email to say this is what I think, which is my opinion. I'm just trying to look at some of the questions. Courtney asked, what forms of marketing do you think we could use as attendees? So social media, et cetera. Also, how are we limited in marketing in terms of law society rules? So the law society is the rules. Touting is not allowed in terms of what the law society says, but you will have noted that if you look at the definition of touting, it's going out there and getting somebody who's probably, if the client belongs to attorney X, and you go out there and you solicit, you try to get that person as a client. So some of those things will fall under touting. So the law society, I don't think prohibits advertising. You can advertise. There have been advertisement of established law firms on social media, even on TV recently. So that's not prohibited. There's the unethical behavior that law society are prohibiting, and also making sure that the people that go out and tout for services for you, if you are an attorney, you cannot get somebody who's not an attorney. For example, you can getting an estate agent to be getting services for you. So those are the things that you need to be careful about. So just make sure that you look at the rules and understand the framework that you need to operate in. But there is no prohibition against marketing or having a marketing strategy. Definitely, it's Dronelda. You can send me that email, and I'll see how I can help you with that. Phineas Mulele asked, could you perhaps elaborate on how to gain information on competitor pricing, as not all get to share same in their publicly available information about them? Phineas, what I will do is, you know, sometimes set up a meeting with, I think attorneys need to network more. Attorneys need to work together more. Even though you are competing, the Law Society organizes a lot of, you know, seminars which I think are networking opportunities. And there, when you are in those networking opportunities, you need to know, that's where you get to know about many attorneys, where they are operating, and what they are, what processes they follow. What processes they follow in their practices, the challenges, and so on and so on. So I think it's more about marketing. If the information is not publicly available on their websites, it's more about marketing. And you find a lot of attorneys are willing to share this with you, even though you are competitors. We are competing, but we are also colleagues in the same breath. I think we've dealt with most of the questions. Like I said, if there are any further questions, I'm happy to deal with those offline. Feel free to use my email address and send me anything if you need assistance, and then we can look at how we can help each other. David Clute is asking me, so that are you saying you must polish your professional image? Definitely, David. I think it falls under how you position yourself. Under, you know, attorneys, most of the time when you say to someone that I'm an attorney, they think you're somebody who's going to read them off. We need to work on that. Our professional image, we need to work on that. So it's very important. In the absence of any further questions, let me just say thank you. I was very honored to be presenting to you today. There'll probably be more, you know, webinars either on this topic or on other topics, and I hope to engage further with most of you on and offline. So thank you, everyone. I see the Lane Cresswell, Adams, Ishmael, Claire, David Luther, Jeanette, David Lee. Thank you, everyone. And hope to engage with you again.